Well, it started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing. Well, opening weekend of our 2020 spring meet here at Gulfstream Park continues. Day number four on this Sunday afternoon. Palm trees at attention outside as there is a slight breeze coming in off the Atlantic Ocean. A couple of furlongs here from us at Gulfstream Park as we move from that outside shot to our clubhouse studios. A few stories above the finish line at historic Gulfstream Park. Jason Blewett, a good Sunday, everybody out there. It's always good to have your company. We absolutely appreciate it. We do have some business to take care of here over the next few hours. In fact, no fewer than 11 races to be run on this Sunday, April the 5th. Here at Gulfstream Park on a program certainly led and I think anchored, to be fair, a bit later on by a couple of good-looking maiden special weight races, and are very much looking forward to those second half of the program. It does begin, though, as far as like the big money multi-race wagers. Obviously, we've got that early pick five, but the Rainbow Six, and we did have a horse alive yesterday for a $685,000 jackpot winning payout. That horse did not, unfortunately for whoever was alive, win, but we do have $500,000, half a mil guaranteed in the Sunday Rainbow Six that begins in one of those aforementioned maiden special weights, race number six this afternoon. Hot riding Tyler Gaffalione sees action throughout the program, and Tyler quickly has picked up 10 wins here, and considering we've run only 3 days this meet, that is certainly a nice accomplishment. He'll be in action, as well as trainer Safi Joseph Jr., who does send out the main story of this upcoming Sunday first. And by the way, we are indeed, as you can see from the graphic, fast and firm. Now, I put it this way, I toyed in my mind with singling Safi's horse here in the first, and in the end, as far as this early pick five goes, and in the end, I said, you know, I don't fully trust the 11, Tumbadora. If this filly by Awesome Again goes out there and wins by 5, 6, or 10 lengths, it won't surprise me, but I wanted coverage because I just think it's really hard to trust a horse who may be in the realm of even money. More on that in a few seconds. Using the two dominant speeds in the second, along with the five who I picked, La Cara Bonita. I didn't think she ran all that well last time out, but I think she's a better horse than her effort March 4th, and she may get a very great trip in that race. The trip, and a great one at that, is the real appeal of the two Kiffel, who is obviously my single in this $27 play, and my feeling, and I think a lot of people's feelings, are going to be that this daughter of Take Charge Indy may just get to the lead and never look back, beneath jockey Luis Saez. She'll go favored in the third race. I'm going to single the number two Kiffel. Race number four, I'm only two deep there, using the new Rich Averill and Georgina Baxter claim in the two Apache Brave, who's got some races sneakily on the go back, and clearly, as far as recent races go, the five Cryogenic has been running maybe not head and shoulders better than the others in the field, but he is the current razor sharp inform horse for trainer Mike Maker, 2-5 in the fourth. I do like the fifth race as we close things down with the maiden special weight. I'm using the four who I picked, Amadora, second out for Brendan Walsh, the five Kashan, who, not to say she's running out of chances, but I'm hoping she runs a little bit better than she has in her three races to date, and there is an absolute wild card status on the outside in the eight. See you at the Breakers, a lengthy layoff horse and a trainer change to the great Hall of Famer Bill Mott. Got to cover my bases, well-pedigreed, Florida-bred at that, and a trainer change to Bill Mott. That horse has to be on that $27 play. Getting back, though, to that first race in the 11 Tumbadora, who, for better or for worse, is going to be a wickedly short price in this upcoming 3-and-up Philly and Mare $12,500 maiden claiming race. You've got a horse who I think, the moral of the story for me is, I think you can find, even though I picked her, you can find better 6-5, 7-5, even money shots than this filly by Awesome Again. It is hard to really gauge her because she was claimed off Gilberto Zerpa, got bet for Zerpa first time out, and after showing some speed, just backed up. Safi saw fit to take her for $25,000. I find it a little interesting. He has basically taken his time getting her back to the races before, again, cutting her claiming tag in half from $25,000 to $12,500. She's had slightly over 50 days between her last start and today. Will I be surprised if she wins? Absolutely not. But again, I think you can just find better odds on or close to odds on favorites than her. And I'll tell you, there's a lot to be said about the 5 Water Wizard, who may be a distant or co-second choice when it's all said and done. Her last race was pretty solid, and this is a race where you're going to have some horses coming in with some changing variables off their last starts. But I think in a field like this, not ignoring all those changes, but you got to put a lot of stock with a horse who, big price aside last time out, just ran a solid race at the level and showed some good speed in the process. Let's move on to the turf. We've got a half a dozen grass races on this Sunday afternoon here at Gulfstream Park. A 3-and-up filly mare, 2 lifetime, $20,000 to $18,000 claimer. That I think off the bat, it's almost a two-headed sort of pre-race nugget that I think is the most important. It's a combination of the 9 Swirling Candy and the number 5 La Cara Bonita, who look arguably best on paper. It's their rematch on the surface of things from March 4th. Taking that a step further, is this a case where the 9 Swirling Candy is able to blast off from the outside and get loose, or is she hooked early by the 1 Madam Barrister, who's first-time Rohan Crichton on the rail off a little bit of a layoff? I think there's a very good chance that the 1 and 9 both hook up, and if that happens, I mean, perhaps they could just duel and run 1-2 around the turf course. We see that happen quite often here, but I'm hoping anyway that La Cara Bonita is the one that's basically right up close, licking her chops as the 1 and 9 both vie eye-to-eye, essentially, in La Cara Bonita, who did not really run all that well last time out. It's a better looking race on paper than it was if you watch the replay, but I'm hoping she trips out, and I think she's a far better horse than the effort she put forth March 4th, even though she did land, admittedly, in a good trip that afternoon. Here's the third back on the main track here as our Fast and Firm Sunday card continues. Got some older filly mare, $10,000 to $8,000 claimers in this race, and as I noted with the early pick 5, I see a potential zero-sum type game as far as the pace situation is concerned in this race. And with Louis riding basically the Ohio invader for Ron Paolucci for Luch Racing, I'm thinking Luch, being as sharp as he is just, and Louis, of course, doing his homework and riding so confident, right to the lead with Kiffle, and hopefully this horse's out-of-town form translates well to a $10,000 claimer here at Gulfstream Park. In fact, the other horse that I thought was the main danger anyway to the 2 Kiffle happened to be another potential more or less tracking or pressing speed in the number 3, Nothing's Free. Like the idea of giving this mare by Flat Out, who's as honest as the day is long, about 80 days between her last start and today, and she, although lost her last start as an odds-on favorite, that was a very legit, awful stumble where she basically hit the dirt, came up, and still ran second, and she's dangerous off the layoff this afternoon for Victor Barboza Jr. Let's move on to the fourth, and I find of the first few races, I find this one to be the most interesting. Just maybe it's because in terms of just overall quality, this is the best field we've had thus far on the card, but I do like this race, not only because you've got the 5 Cryogenic, who seems like a very reasonable short price favorite you can have a lot of confidence in, because his last couple sprinting on the turf for Mike Maker have been so solid. But I like that there's also a new face here, and you know, Rich Averill has obviously made some great claims over the years, a payday price. He's got that rocket ship Philly dirt horse who's won a bunch of Ladies Island, in fact, who's now a graded stakes winner. And I like the idea of Rich going in and taking the 2 Apache Brave, and the fact that, well, they laid up this gelding who's riding a long winless streak. That's got to be pointed out. But giving this horse about 3.5 months between races and going off the claim today with a ton of back class. I mean, this horse has been, or was, put it this way, ambitiously campaigned and placed in the majority of his races. That probably has a lot to do with the fact that he has not won a race since basically Halloween, right around Halloween of 2017. So you're talking well over 2 years ago, but he's running a bunch of stakes and he's kept good company. And that's the thing with Georgina. Not only are her horses always gate sharp, she seems to do really well with these older horses that maybe have quite a few miles on the odometer, and she's also really good with turf sprinters. So Apache Brave, for me anyway, checks all the boxes, coming back at a very reasonable spot this afternoon for connections that are just very sharp and I have a lot of respect for. 5-2 for me in race number 4. Fifth race on the program, back on the main. We basically alternated from dirt to turf throughout the first few races, and in fact, this opening pick 5, as we check out this Florida bred 3-and-up filly mare, $40,000 maiden special weight. Now, as far as this fifth race is concerned, I guess the 5 Kashan is the filly to beat for Ben Perkins Jr., where it might be slight, it might be somewhat narrow, but I do think when push comes to shove, off her 3 races to date on the dirt, she has run the best of these on the main track. Has she run dynamite? No. Have her races been crazily good? No. Are there some new shooters in here that are probably going to improve? Absolutely. So Kashan, my point is, Kashan could have a tough time if she doesn't step forward in her fourth lifetime start for Ben Perkins Jr. And as far as stepping forward, well, call me pretty optimistic here with the 4, Amadora, who got bet, had Tyler for Brendan Walsh first time out, and did not run here in the middle of last month. In fact, she was beaten a pole. I'm encouraged that Tyler doesn't jump ship. There's no layoff. There's no drop down. After all, this is a fairly, not modestly bred, but this is not some crazy expensive purchase Florida bred filly by Golden Sense. I like that there's no drop in class. There's no switch to the turf. I'm wondering if maybe there was a little bit of an issue, maybe in race, and Brendan feels he has that corrected. And with Tyler back aboard this afternoon off such an effort that looks well, quite frankly, ugly on paper, I think Amadora is going to be a filly that really, or at least hopefully, steps back or takes a step forward and shows us taking a step back why she was bet so strongly in her debut. She's a little bit of a wild card, but I think the biggest quote-unquote wild card in this fifth race field is the Donald Disney hard-spun filly on the outside in the 8 CU at the Breakers. You don't know, of course, can she run on the dirt, because she had 2 races last summer at Belmont Park as a 2-year-old. Ran okay in those races for trainer Mark Cassie. I'm going to include her just because, well, she's a Florida-bred by hardspun out of a very good race mare in Calistoga. And I like the fact that Bill Mott, a few years back, about a decade ago, in fact, trained Calistoga, won 3 of 8 with her. So he's got some familiarity with the family, and I'm going to take her, or at least include her, as a wild card in race number 5. We do have some outstanding maiden turf coming up in a few more races, including Ronnie. 500 guaranteed Rainbow 6 after this. And that Sport of Kings promo is still good. Free money there, $10 credit, up to a $500 bonus with the First Bet app. Definitely check that out if you haven't already. And why don't we as a group check out for the first time, I might add. No teasers or spoilers. I have not seen Ron Nicoletti's Jackpot Rainbow 6 ticket, which, much like yesterday, clocks in at $48.60. So this is a heavy-handed 3-horse spread in 5 of the 6 races in the Sunday Rainbow 6. And Ronnie was able to do that because he's obviously got a single looming in race number 8 this afternoon. And the 6 Voodoo Zip will be favored there and has run three very solid races on the turf. And I think, although his margin for error is slim, and that's a pretty deep race, he is the horse to beat. And I like Voodoo Zip as well. 48.60 for good old Ronzoni there. And we'll catch up with Ronnie and Acacia offside a bit later as the card progresses. Let's move on to this sixth race field, and we'll talk about a few of these. And this is very much a race to a large extent where maybe good things or potentially good things come in pairs. There's a couple of horses trained by Christophe Comont in the mix. There's also a couple of Uncle Mo fillies, which you know makes me happy. And one of those daughters of Mo happens to be the one, Gotta Go Mo, for John Kimmel from The Whale. And I think she's a worthy starting point because she's run very well without winning, of course, but her turf races of late have been good. And in fact, her four-race or five-race career culminated with a tough beat loss last time out at the start of March. Here's the race with Gotta Go Mo, who just really ran well, never had a breather, is more or less a chasing, vying outside speed. And you can watch essentially the winner, the number one, Notorious RBG, in this race, who basically, I mean, was licking her chops there off the far turn and landed in the perfect trip as she pocketed up, angled 3 to 4 wide, and she'll wear everybody down. But, I mean, you can see for yourself how game and resolute Gotta Go Mo was between horses, and she's just a major player here for trainer John Kimmel. Moving on to the Clement-trained fillies and a good dose of the Orb filly, who is pretty pricey, and the two backside beauty. Let's get three horses out of the way with one nice, neat graphic. I am very much a fan of both of these Clement horses, and I picked the number 5, Avuncular, who's third on the list here. I like the fact that the dam, in fact, was a minor turf winner. She was 1 for 6 on the turf, and there is a minor older turf winning sister in the immediate family of the 5 Avuncular. The other Clement filly, the 3 No-No Nina, is by more than ready. And she is only running for the second time, so you are likely going to get a big leap forward with the more-than-ready presence on the turf, second time out for Christophe. And needless to say, Christophe, very dangerous in this upcoming sixth field. And Backside Beauty may be eligible to run well first time out. She was an original $60,000 yearling, Pinhook for more than double that as a 2-year-old at $150,000. Dam won 3 turf races. There's been mixed results regarding her production. This is the 7th foal out of His Beauty, again, who did win 3 races on the turf. And I would imagine with that big recent breeze going 5 on the turf at Palm Meadows, there is reason to believe that the 2 Backside Beauty could be very live. So nice mix there with the 2 first-time starting well-bred fillies for Christophe trying the turf. You've got Kimmel's Uncle Mo filly on the rail, who's been solid, and a daughter of a former Florida Derby winner in Orb in the 2 Backside Beauty. Let's start the late pick 5, shall we, as we move on to race number 7. Back on the main, 2 chalks for me to start. I am 4-6 in this race, and more on those 2 horses in a second. I didn't single Ronnie's top selection. He obviously is very bullish on the 6 Voodoo Zip, but I wanted to cover my bases to an extent using the 4 Express Pharaoh, who I think that horse found a mile and a furlong just way too far last time out, and I like that he's getting less distance. And I included Christophe's number 11, Shamrockette, the Florida bred, stepping up and trying opens. My single is housed in race number 9 this afternoon, and in fact, it's the 9, Roman Empire, who to me looks like a really nice Florida bred in the making for Todd Pletcher, and I've liked both those horses' races to date. I love the 10th race. That might not be one of the undercard maiden specials we've talked about a few different times on the show thus far, but that's a solid-looking Philly and Mare allowance race that has a very intriguing Up in Smoke, who's one of 3 I used in the race, returning for George Weaver off just an unbelievable allowance win last time out, and a very tricky cash out, 5, 7, and 10 for me in a race I think you want coverage to close things down on day number 4 of the spring meet. Moving back, though, and taking a step back, I am very much in the camp of the 2 likely strongest best horses in the late pick 5 opener. Subsidiary, the 4, has got the speed. So, I mean, she's probably the best speed horse in the mix for Mark Cassie. Check. And then you've got the drop down and the real class relief. And I think in many metrics, the horse to beat in the 6 Sky Chaser, who's not slow either. That's a feather in her cap, perhaps. And there's just no denying the fact that she has spent 2020 and a good chunk of 2019against significantly better competition down in class this afternoon for trainer Ronnie Spatz. Eighth race is a solid highlight today. Three-year-old maiden turfers. Let's get right into the replay here, and we'll show you what Voodoo Zip did last time out. And although he did not walk away with the maiden diploma, he ran an exceptional race for our good friends over at West Point Thoroughbreds. Unfortunately for him, there was a pricey and obviously very perfectly prepped and well-prepped Chad Brown, first-time turfer, to his outside here in the red cap for OXO in vintage print. But to his credit, Voodoo Zip on the rail in the black cap just did not want to give things up, and he fought tooth and nail in a race that came up fast on Beyer and just looks legit in terms of quality. They gapped out the field by good ways. A solid effort last time out from the horse, quite simply, to beat in a good-looking field in race number 8. Meanwhile, we've got the other rematch with Express Pharaoh and Scano, who are both coming out of a race here on March 7. Scano ran well, and he has often, in fact, all his races, he's been a good price. He's never been shorter than 9-2. He was more or less an outside speed. Keep your eye, though, on the 2 Express Pharaoh, who did have a very good trip, just pocketed up, saved ground, and he'll tip out and try to cut everybody down. You watch how he starts to drift beneath left-handed urging there, and I just, at the end of the day, as he started to idle at this point, and the gray horse for John Kimmel cuts everybody down and gets the bob here in a blanket three-horse photo, I'm thinking that for Express Pharaoh, he just found nine furlongs on the turf too far, and I really like him turning back to a mile this afternoon. He's dangerous in this race, along with the 11 Shamrock Ket. Now, he's coming out of his three-year-old debut here in early March, beaten by Proven Strategies, who will get some evidence as to the quality of that race in a 1-2 punch, because not only is Shamrock Ket coming back here in the ninth, or eighth race, rather, you've got Proven Strategies returning in the ninth race, and that's where we're headed next. Moving on to this Florida bred, allow its optional claimer on the turf, going a mile and a 16th. Proven Strategies has run a good race in all of his starts to date, and obviously needed that first start back against Fancy Liquor and Counter-Strike, and dropped in against Restricted Florida Breds and beat Shamrock Ket last time out. He's a major player as the number 6 horse for Tyler and Mark Cassie. The 9 Roman Empire, to me, though, looks like a horse who really took that nice forward move in his second start. And I kind of like the idea of Todd putting a horse who ran well first time out on the turf back on the grass, even though his last race was such a dominant performance on the main. Really like what I saw last time out with the 9 Roman Empire. So I am JBM's, the last out maiden winners to sweep the exact in this spot, over the number 4 Resident Liberal, who's coming out of a monstrously tough allowance field won by Golden Tappet, who, mark my words, I think that horse is a graded stakes horse in the making for trainer Brendan Walsh. Let's hit double digits as we move on to the 10th race, and this is going to be the one replay as we take our last lap today around the main track, and we cap the action on the main on the dirt in style with a good-looking cast of 3 and up fillies and mares. Watch this last out effort. If you haven't seen it yet, or if you have seen it, you likely didn't forget it, because although this was not a performance that, you know, broke the teletimer in terms of a winning time or anything like that, you watch Up in Smoke, who at this point is 4-5, went off odds on in this race, and she's completely out of the picture. Not only out of the picture, she fell out of the picture, or dropped out of the picture, beneath a full out drive beneath John Velasquez. Somehow, someway, field to get closer to the quarter pole, and they'll whip around off the far turd, and here she comes back into the picture. Johnny will go right-handed, gets her outside, and this was just one of those remarkable, like unforgettable performances out of Up in Smoke. Now, again, I know the race didn't come up all that fast in terms of a time or a speed figure, and this is a way, way, way tougher spot this afternoon in terms of depth as she steps up, not only not facing Florida Breds anymore, because that was Restricted Florida Bred allowance, she's running against some older fillies and mares in this spot as well. But that was an awesome effort out of Up in Smoke. Is she a little more developed in this race where she doesn't make or have to make multiple moves? We'll find out. Shug's got another 3-year-old who's also very promising and interesting. Second time out this meet, or at least second time out this year at Gulfstream in the 4 Alondra, who I gave props for just winning and winning solidly around Labor Day at Saratoga as a Shug firster and a Shug two-year-old. They took her to Keeneland, favored in the Alcibiades against British Idiom. She didn't run well in the Demoiselle, but the point is her three-year-old filly debut was a good effort in a race that came up solidly fast and a good field at that. And I just think with Shug, given the quality this horse showed as a two-year-old, she's going to improve this afternoon and take a step forward. She'll need to, because not only is the aforementioned Up in Smoke in the race, you've got Our Prerogative, whose speed inside, and one of those older fillies, and Safi's horse, Midtown Rose, is a five-time winner with 5 seconds from 15 starts. Just a good mix between fillies that are very much promising at this point against some more established older horses in the race. I kind of like that demarcation line, if you will, in today's 10th. And I'll do the nightcap quickly here so we can get Pete on with those changes. Race number 11 is a 3-and-up filly mare, 3-lifetime, 12-5 to 10-5 claimer. We're on the turf here going a mile. Real scramble here. You would imagine this is a race, and maybe it's unsatisfying to say in a handicapping preview show at 12:40 in the afternoon, but I think you're going to need to get a good trip and obviously just have a lot of racing luck on your side. I'm with the 5 Catnip Kitten. Liked the race last time out for Armando. I would give a look to the Georgina trainer change for Midwest. The number 7 Got the Gist, and even the number 10 Chicklet's Dream claimed for more money off Chad Brown last time. That horse drops off the claim this afternoon for Amador Sanchez. A very difficult turf cash out to end day number 4, but we're just getting started. It's not 1 o'clock yet. That means it's time to send it on up to track announcer Pete Aiello for those Sunday scratches and changes.